if there was any possibility that his daughter Mary might be able to find, or if she could find for his daughter Mary, a job in the household. In those days, for somebody to get a job in the big house, as they were referred to, the mansions, the estates, stately homes, owned by predominantly English settlers. Once you got a job in one of those establishments, you were set up for life. So Lady Mulchnock agreed to take Mary on as a servant. But what she didn't know for a long period of time was that Mary came to work in the house, but she fell in love with Lady Mulchnock's son, William. And William fell in love with Mary. But for somebody from the, we say, that side of the divide to be seen in a relationship with somebody from the working class, gentry and the working class just did not mix, you know, not socially certainly, and not in terms of a relationship, definitely not, would be totally frowned upon. So their relationship for a long time was kept a secret until one of Mary's fellow servants found out about it and through jealousy informed the lady of the house. William was told he'd have to cease the relationship straight away or face being disinherited, losing all the power, the land, the money that he would ultimately inherit, being the son. And he cowered out. He chose to abandon Mary and left Tralee at the time, went to serve in the English army in India. Lord Mary was left. She was dismissed from the household because, as I said, that would have been totally frowned upon for somebody of her stature being involved with somebody from the gentry. She was dismissed from the household. And, sorry, it's just like, years later, on a return visit from India, William came home and he was met in the town of Tralee by a funeral cortege. When he went into a shop to get out of the way of the funeral cortege, he asked the shopkeeper who was dead, and he said, the man replied that it was a local shoemaker by the name of O'Connor. William just inquired further and said, didn't he have a daughter called Mary? And the shopkeeper replied, yes, he did. She died years ago of a broken heart. Right? So he followed the cortege to the cemetery, saw where shoemaker was being buried, and saw on the headstone after the crowd had disappeared that Mary's name was written on the headstone prior to her father. And it's reputed that he sat down and wrote the words to the Rose of Tralee. At the pageant, this huge festival, it's a week-long festival every year, is to celebrate the inner beauty of the winner of the pageant, the Rose of Tralee, because the lines of the song go, she was lovely and fair like the rose of the summer, yet it was not her beauty alone that won me. Oh no, it was the truth in her eyes ever dawning that made me love Mary, the Rose of Tralee. So if you know it, please feel free to join in. A pale moon was rising above the green mountain. The sun was declining beneath the blue sea. When I strayed with my love to the pure crystal fountain that stands in the beautiful vale of Tralee. She was lovely and fair, like the rose of the summer. not one mean. Oh no, it was the truth in her eyes, ever dawning, that made me love Mary, the Rose of Tralee. The cool shades of evening, their mantles were spreading, and Mary, all smiling, sat listening to me. The moon through the valley, her pale rays was shedding. When I won the heart of the Rose of Tralee, she was lovely and fair, like the rose of the summer. Yet it was not her beauty alone that won me. Oh no, it was the truth in her eyes ever dawning that made me love Mary, the Rose of Tralee. Oh no, it was the truth.